Hey guys, today I'm on location at Ryan's Comics in beautiful Murrieta, California. Tomorrow is Free Comic Book Day, so I thought that I would celebrate by sharing with all of you some of the free comics that I've gotten over the years. Let's start things off with Rocket Raccoon number 1. For those of you whose exposure to the character Rocket Raccoon is limited exclusively to the Guardians of the Galaxy movie, I recommend you check out my review for the original Rocket Raccoon miniseries here. It is the best kind of insane you'll ever see in a comic. It also helps that you catch yourself up on Rocket's original history, since, surprisingly, today's comic plays more into that continuity than it does with the current comics. We open on a spaceship that looks like a giant bunny head, which is appropriate since it's being piloted by a rabbit space mercenary, Blackjack O'Hare. He informs his leader, Lord Divine, who, lest we forget, comes from a planet made up entirely of crazy people, where he runs a toy empire and uses animal crackers as currency. This comic makes that sentence possible. About how they've picked up the signal of a nearby cargo ship, but no contact between them can be made. They beam the ship aboard and send in some mercenary bunnies to investigate, but they're quickly taken out by a mysterious, bushy-tailed silhouette. He knocks out a couple of guards and reveals himself to be Rocket Raccoon.
Mr. Wal-Rus, this is Rocket Raccoon. I'm in the brig. Have you infiltrated the network yet?
We jump back to Rocket's ship, where all kinds of hell is being rained down upon the bunny guards from something off-panel. Wal-Rus replies,
It's impossible to concentrate with all this racket.
It would be less impossible if your utility tusks were actually plugged into the computer. Wal-Rus hacks in and relays the cell number of someone they're trying to rescue to Rocket.
Pucker up, princess. Here comes your knight in shining.
Boot to the head.
Unfortunately, his would-be rescuee is not happy.
Who are you? I'm looking for Princess Lynx.
You expected bluebirds and sparkle dust?
No, but I think it's fair for him to expect someone who looks a bit more like a lynx, not someone with vague lynx-like features while retaining enough humanity for the reader to not feel weird about finding her attractive. Frankly, Rocket here looks more like a lynx than she does.
My father's the king, yes, but on Felis I, that makes me commander of the armed forces. I'm a warrior princess.
I imagine you're not a very good warrior princess if your father has to rely on mercenaries to rescue the leader of his armed forces. Actually, she's angry at Rocket for rescuing her because she was counting on her own people to rescue her within 27 minutes, but hey, any port in a storm, lady. Let this guy rescue you and call off your troops once you're out of harm's way, or just use them for backup if things start to go wrong. More bunny guards show up and prove to be as effective as Imperial stormtroopers. Unfortunately, Blackjack O'Hare shows up to turn the tide in his favor.
Blackjack O'Hare! I see you and your Black Bunny Brigade are back in the service of evil.
Evil? Blackjack seemed mostly motivated by the highest bidder, not evil.
Nothing personal, Rocky, old pal, but you're getting in the way of commerce. That princess is worth a mint.
Before he can blast him, Princess Lynx grabs him, elbows the wall like she's in roller derby, and escapes down the elevator shaft. Much to their chagrin, they end up in Lord Divine's throne room.
I haven't seen your weaselly little face in a Skrull's age.
I've been... busy.
So I've heard. Rigel IV, Wraith World, Galador. Your reputation is growing.
So not only is Rom Space Knight still a vital part of the Marvel Universe, but so are the Simpsons? After Divine gloats about how Rocket will bring in an even greater bounty than that of the princess by herself, who should show up to save the day but Rocket's sidekick, Groot? And it's a good thing that he told us this, otherwise we might mistake this giant tree monster for a pile of sentient intestines. Sentient intestines? After he makes off with Divine's crown, Rocket and his friends head for their ship.
Leave it to the men to run from a battle. My people would hang you for that!
I'm pretty sure that your people would also run from the battle once they got you out of harm's way. Would they hang themselves too? She says she has to stay for her rescue team to get her, but Rocket tells her that, for reasons he can't disclose, they aren't coming. With no other options, she hops aboard and they make their escape. Once they're in the clear, Rocket sneaks off to talk with our old friend Lord Pyko. You remember, the crazy toy engineer who built rocket engines into his shell? Man, that was awesome. He's pleased with how Wal-Rus was able to hack into the communication system of the Felician rescue team and send them halfway across the galaxy. So yeah, it's implied that Rocket took her because he wants her bounty for himself, but then he says that the rescue attempt was a bust. Pyko doesn't completely believe Rocket, and he emphasizes that with the kind of money that she'd bring in, Rocket could easily wipe his own criminal record clean. With this in mind, Rocket tells Wal-Rus to set course for the planet Laxidasia. Not to turn in the princess, but to see how much they can get for Lord Divine's crown. I guess he's starting to fall for the princess. A good punch in the face will do that to a guy. The end. Really? The end? Not to be continued in Rocket Raccoon number whatever? That's the story? It's kind of a weird place to end it. I mean, were we introduced to all of our old friends from the original Rocket Raccoon comics, except for Princess Lila, where is she in all of this? They're off to begin a brand new adventure, and then it just stops? What happened after they're leaving Half-World that led into this comic? Since Rocket's been gallivanting about with the Guardians of the Galaxy for the last few years, how did he reunite with all of his old friends here? Do Rocket's friends know that they just kidnapped a wanted fugitive whom Rocket has no intention of turning in and collecting the bounty? I think the scat might hit the fan after that little revelation, but I guess we'll never know since the comic doesn't tell us where to continue reading. Since that little tease of a comic went absolutely nowhere, let's see if Guardians of the Galaxy number 1 can better whet our appetites. Our comic opens on what I can only assume is Avengers Tower, thanks to that big letter A hanging on the wall. We see Tony Stark holding a briefing with Corporal Flash Thompson about partaking in a secret mission set out in space. Do you know who the Guardians are? The Space Guardians? Is that a thing? Oh yeah, they're little blue Oompa Loompas who make weaponized mood rings. Tony then proceeds to explain to us, Corporal Thompson, who the Guardians of the Galaxy are. He talks briefly about their personal histories and personalities. There's really not much about them that differs from what we've seen in the movie, except that Star-Lord knows who his father is, and he's not too happy about it. Maybe an editorial box pointing us to a comic explaining why would be nice. Oh, and the Guardians apparently suffer from Youngblood's disease, because I guess having pupils is overrated. It's not like you need eyes to shoot guns, am I right? While Tony's talking about the Guardians, we see them fighting an unnamed alien race doing I don't know what. My guess is nobody told them that the first Avengers movie had already wrapped, and the Guardians are just being bouncers at this point. Tony is also keen to point out that Rocket Raccoon doesn't like being called a raccoon. Why not? That's his name, and it's been his name ever since 1982. The introductions are wrapped up with Rocket's sidekick, who can convey a wider range of ideas than you might imagine just by him introducing himself.
I am Groot.
I'm Batman.
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 I am Groot.
So basically, they're kind of like pirates, meaning that they'll start off strong with the first movie, but each sequel will just get weirder and weirder. Robin Hoodie kind of pirates, with hearts of gold. He said as the Guardians are committing wholesale slaughter. I don't remember that from the Robin Hood story. The meeting ends with Tony saying that they need an Avenger to represent humanity on the Guardian side, and he thinks that Thompson is just the man for the job. He accepts Tony's proposal, and all the Guardians come in from another room to welcome him into the fold. I'm actually amazed that this big reveal wasn't spoiled by Rocket shooting everything that moves, or Groot not scraping his head against the ceiling. Suit up. And then Thompson turns into Venom.
Agent Venom reporting for duty.
Yeah, if you're only casually familiar with these characters, you're not going to have any idea what just happened. Gotta give the comic credit. It made me curious enough to look up what the ever-loving crap this is all about. It would appear that the U.S. government got their hands on the Venom symbiote and tried to use it as a weapon. They gave Flash Thompson the chance to use it on only a handful of missions, since they were afraid of it taking over him like it had done with Peter Parker and Eddie Brock before him. So how does Flash keep the suit under control? He gives it drugs to keep it sedated. Remember, kids, don't do drugs. Unless they help keep your superpowers in check. And I know that the suit goes into the skin of its host, but where did all this paraphernalia come from? Did he literally pull that rifle out of his ass? While the other Guardians are admiring Flash's new duds, Tony pulls Star-Lord aside and hands him a space condom? I really don't think you'll need it, but I am Mr. Just-in-Case. Just in case you run into any unforeseen symbiote trouble. Yep, definitely a space condom. Then the comic ends with Star-Lord and Venom having a little stare-down. Or at least I think they're having a little stare-down. Is he looking at Tony? I can't tell how dramatic this is since he doesn't have any pupils.
Is he paying attention?
To be continued in Guardians of the Galaxy. Maybe including an issue number would help. Hey, you want to see where this standalone one-shot continues? Good luck, because we ain't telling ya! But to be fair, this comic does do a better job of getting your attention than Rocket Raccoon. It outlines the main characters, gives you a breakdown of the premise, and that's the whole point of these free comics, to get you interested enough to keep on coming back for more. Maybe even more than meets the eye?
More.